Part 2.
I saw her today. This exact girl. Only she didn't look human. There's some kind of connection between her, the old carnival, and the Miles County clown. What if you're connected too?
So after being terrorized by Art, the pale girl, and a raccoon, Jonathan returns home to tell Sienna that he saw Art the clown and his new friend, the pale girl. Now, I know a lot of people are saying that Art the Clown is Sienna and Jonathan's father, which is why the two of them are the only people that can see the Pale Girl, but I don't know. Isn't that just a little bit too Star Wars-y? We already have the prophecy element of Sienna being the chosen one who has the power to defeat Art. Must we double down? I'm sorry, but I don't see it. Up until now, Leon has been pretty fresh about his ideas. I don't see him making them one big giant family. Also, that would imply that at some point there's going to be some type of catharsis between Sienna and Art the Clown, and it's going to get sentimental, and that's not Terrifier, right? I think the reason that Jonathan can see the pale-faced girl is because his dad gave him the power to do so. Much like how Freddy derives his power from people knowing of his existence, I think the same could be said about the pale-faced girl. Keep in mind, Jonathan has read the news clipping about this girl before actually seeing her. And it's only after Jonathan tells Sienna about her dad that she's also able to see the girl as well. Speaking of which, this article is pretty damn interesting. Written by the love child of Wes Craven and Jack Torrance, a grim fate was in store for a young girl after a celebration of the town carnival this Halloween. 10-year-old Emily Crane, seen right, was last seen alive cheerfully roaming the carnival grounds earlier Friday evening. As the night progressed and the attractions closed, family members grew concerned as to her whereabouts. Several carnival goers worked alongside family and friends to search for the young girl, which came to an end shortly after it began. Crane's lifeless, mangled body was discovered in a makeup trailer just outside the main event grounds. Crane was the daughter of two prominent circus performers, whose family also includes a long line of very popular, well-respected circus acts, mimes, and similar talents. Police suggested that her death may be linked to a series of murders, and I can't make out the rest. His thumb's in the way. But this is the hidden bit I find the most interesting. Crane was the daughter of two prominent circus performers, whose family also includes a long line of very popular, well-respected circus acts, mimes, and similar talents. I'm sorry, but am I the only one who thinks that Emily Crane might be the daughter of Art the Clown? Here's my take. I don't think Emily Crane is the actual daughter of the demon-killing clown that we know as Art the Clown. I think a lot like Pennywise, Art the Clown was in fact a real person at some point before an evil entity, probably from the Ninth Circle, took the appearance of Art the Clown to get close to Emily under the pretense of being her real-life father. Let me explain. Leon makes a point of recreating the scene from the original film. Why? I think it's because he wants to remind us that possession is very much an element of this movie. Going back to the original film, Vicky is seen as being very much a human being that has been traumatized by a killer clown. Moments later, we get a brief glimpse of her visually shaking and being possessed in some way. The news lady even says,
"Oh my god, I thought she was going to attack me."
Her eye is also looking a little bit yellow in this scene as well. It's subtle, but it's there. Skip to the post-credit scene, and now Vicky's eye is glowing bright yellow and laughing maniacally. Clearly, this is not Vicky anymore. And while I don't have solid proof of this, I think it's because at the end of Terrifier, Art the Clown can be seen eating Vicky's face off. They don't show it, but they refer to it. Now, with all that in mind, let's take a look at Emily Crane. In the second half of the film, we see her sitting in front of a makeup mirror, which I assume is the same one referred to in the news article. And while I can't show it here, we know that she uses a few, tools to, rearrange her face. You look like a man-o-lantern, or in this case, a lady lantern. But my theory is that, under the guise of being Emily's father, the demon posing as Art the Clown got close, killed Emily, and ate her face a little bit. But I think it's important because it would establish why some of Art's victims perish and why others become faithful followers. Think of it like vampires, but only with demons. Some get killed and others just join the band. Mind you, I don't think they're the person they used to be. Those people are probably long dead. Their souls might have been trapped somewhere, time will tell, but I think what we're seeing are the members of the Ninth Circle avataring as Art's previous victims and joining him on his unholy crusade. I also think whenever you see a character's eyes light up, That's Satan himself peeking in to make sure everything is going to plan. It would explain their sudden change in demeanor and how they stand there blankly like a security camera, and why there's sometimes those radio frequencies heard in the background.
You're really going to like it here.
Think of these demons as hotspots for the devil himself. The devil knows Sienna is coming for him, and he's throwing everything he can at her, hopefully before she realizes how powerful she is. One of the more interesting things that I heard was on a YouTube channel called Little Punk People, which is hosted by the actor that plays Jonathan.
You need to be rolling at all times, man.
In which he interviews Damien Leone, and Damien says, "I've already admitted that there's a supernatural entity that has brought Art back from the dead, and sort of drives him through the entire movie and actually guides him to you and Sienna and puts him on this mission." Now, what people might not know is that the supernatural entity is actually played by an actor. So you, Jonathan, actually acted with this actor more than anybody else. We're taking a bit of a risk with this character. We're not playing it safe by any means in this movie. We're taking a lot of chances. We're swinging for the fences with this one. So we'll see. We'll see if it pays off. Which I found to be fascinating, as the character he's referring to is clearly the pale-faced girl. Leon also said that initially the character was always going to be a creepy little girl to represent this demon, perhaps even Satan himself. We'll explore that later. So yeah, I think that kind of backs up my theory. I think the devil does peek in from time to time whenever the eyes glow up. I think Leon is being a little, you know, vague about it, and you can understand why, but this seems to all kind of add up. As I said earlier in a previous video, I had been researching Terrifier 2 as early as October 6th when it came out. It's why my End Explained video took so long to put together. I want to do it right. Or as I said in that video, I've seen The Ninth Circle and the Terrifier short twice. I've seen All Hallows Eve twice. I've seen Terrifier 3 times. I've seen Terrifier 2 4 times.
And it keeps getting funnier every single time I see it!
I've watched interviews with Damien Leone and David Harrod Thornton on Spooky Astronauts, Filmspeak, Collider. I've read Wikipedia pages, fandom pages, Reddit pages. I followed actors and directors on social media talking about the film extensively. Yeah, so you get the idea. But it's true, I don't think I've seen a movie like this in my lifetime. This feels like what people described to me, you know, 50 years ago when The Exorcist came out.
I want to see if it's gonna make me throw up.
I don't like it. I want to go home.
It's me. That is one of the most grossest movies in the world.
And you know, people were throwing up in the aisles. Then they were fainting. And now, by today's standards, nothing seems to really do that. The movie has now grown on to make $10+ million on a budget of $250,000, and it just keeps going. It keeps going for another week in theaters, another week. It's on streaming, but it's still making money at the box office. And honestly, it's just a lot of fucking fun. So yeah, I think that backs up my theory. She's the one really running the show in a very, very low-key way. I know in the past, Leon has been quoted as saying to both LaVera and Thornton that they should play the characters as if they were very much like Batman and the Joker. If you've ever seen, or better yet, read The Killing Joke, you know it ends with the Joker kidnapping and torturing Gordon at the abandoned carnival, just so that he can get Batman there for his trap. Sound familiar? And don't get me wrong, I absolutely love that Leon is pulling from the comics, because there are things in the Batman comics, in the Joker comics, that you could never do in a live-action Batman movie. Not one that's made for $200 million, and you have way too many chefs in the kitchen saying that you can't do this, you can't do that. I mean, even on that Harley Quinn show, you got people saying that Batman can't give certain types of pleasure to Catwoman because, and I quote, "heroes don't do that."
Shall I continue?
It's not worth it.
So, if he wants to take inspirations from the comics, the darkest ones that we can never do on a live-action screen, all for it. Hands down, make it happen. Because the Joker in the comics has done some really messed up stuff. Like, just to name a few, the Joker has blown up a school. He has viciously abused and then paralyzed Barbara Gordon. He drove Gordon to the brink of insanity. He killed Jason Todd. He turned Jason Todd into a version of himself. He wore his own face as a mask. He threw Harley Quinn into a vat of acid. He skinned a man alive. I'll say that again. He skinned a man alive. Yeah, try putting that in your movie, Matt Reeves. I'll wait. And he even snapped his own neck just so that he could frame Batman for his own death.
See you in hell.
These are the kind of things we'll never see in a big commercial movie, but a movie that is unrated and made for maybe, let's just say, $1 million? Yeah, sign me up. I'll be there. The very idea of it is giving me goosebumps. As for the pale girl, I think largely she's going to be a pretty good foil for Jonathan. Art and Sienna are fighters. Jonathan and the pale girl are not. In fact, the pale girl hasn't really done anything that evil at all yet, but she does have the power to transform into anyone she likes and completely mess with your head. Jonathan, on the other hand, is book smart. He's the one I predict who is going to continue guiding Sienna with the knowledge that she needs when the battle inevitably goes down into hell. So essentially, it's like, yeah, I mean, I'm sure not the first one to make this comparison, but Jonathan and the pale girl are a little bit like Harley Quinn and Robin. Or you can even say that Jonathan's a little bit like Barbara Gordon because he's just so well informed and, much like the Oracle, knows a lot of stuff. So I'm incredibly curious how this is all going to play out. But in a nutshell, if I had to sum up the pale girl, in my opinion, I think it's a demon from the Ninth Gate taking the form of Art's previous victim, Emily Clark, and then sometimes being tapped into by the devil for updates. That's my theory, just to summarize. What is yours? Comment down below, let me know what you thought of the pale-faced girl. Do you want to see more of her? I really just love all the lore and mythology that they're expanding with this universe. I mean, I like the first Terrifier, it's fun. There's a kill in there that is so incredibly over the top and graphic, it's great. But I'm a sucker for like mythology, especially ones that have never really been done that great on the large screen. Like, I know that Damien Leone has taken a lot of inspiration from sword and wizardry kind of movies from like the 80s, and we don't really have that. You know, we have like that Dungeons and Dragons movie coming out, but that'll suck. I'd love to see a little bit of that genre sprinkled into this hardcore movie. But those are just my thoughts. These are not facts. These are just me kind of taking all the little pieces that I have and putting it all together. Be sure to comment down below. I would love to know what you think of the little pale girl. I think she probably was the best addition in this movie, short of maybe Sienna. But be sure to comment down below. I'd love to get your thoughts about what you think of the Ninth Circle and Sienna and the pale girl, how you think it's going to play out in part 3. What do you want out of part 3? I personally think we're going to go down to hell. I mean, if we're not doing it in this movie, we're doing it in the next one. And if you want to hear more of my thoughts, be sure to check out my Ending Explained video for this movie. It just got like 69,000 views, which again, thank you so much. Thank you so much to the new subscribers. And I'll just keep making these Terrifier 2 videos because I can talk about this movie all day. Like, I'll just pick little topics that interest me and interest you if you say something down in the comments. And yeah. Until next time, guys, thank you so much for watching. I have been John here on Burns Reviews, and we will see you next time.
I don't know what it was that bent your life out of shape, but maybe I've been there too. You don't need to be alone. We don't have to kill each other.
Drop on by the Clown Cafe. Drop on by the Clown Cafe. The grub is downright gruesome, but your appetite's obey. 'Cause food's a little funny. Food's a little funny. Food's a little funny at the club.